Hello everyone, welcome to the class on recent advances in surgical technology. We will continue on the topic on microsurgery and the basics of lasers in this class now. Last class we were dealing about the applications, the advantages, disadvantages of loops, and because of various disadvantages of loops, we have got the surgical operating microscope over the loops there. As I told, the microsurgery is nothing but it's done in the magnifications. This is in the magnifications. And today we're dealing about the continuation of the microsurgery, surgical operating microscope. And the surgical operating microscope as such has got a superior magnification than the loops there, better optical performance, but that requires a clinical proficiency that's important in operating a microscope here. And that the complete operating microscope is based on Galilean optics there. And this microscope has got binocular eyepieces with achromatic lenses. That's the same thing like a prismatic loops there. But the useful range is from 250 to 350 mm for direct vision and 100 to 150 mm for indirect vision. Here we see a Galilean optical principle here. On the right side of the PowerPoint slide there, when you had two lenses of the eyepiece there and the prismatic assembly and the light, I told you that's called as backlight reflection there. And we got a binocular lenses there where it's going to focus the object in a converging rays. On the left side of the PowerPoint slide, we see they've been operating on the patient there. That's a single-eyed surgical operating microscope, where only the operator can see the field over the microscope there. There's one more system where it has got two lenses on the both side, where the both operator and the clinical assistant can visualize the area for the microscope there. Coming to the microsurgical instruments, and this is the one question been asked in the previous exam. What are the microsurgical instruments there? We have various instruments there, unlike your regular perioral surgery. They got the microsurgical knives, scissors, needle holders there, and the needles there, and the sutures there. It's entirely a miniature of the regular surgical instruments there. Coming to microsurgical knives, there's various surgical knives there. That's cast of a microsurgical scalpel, like crescent, a lamellar, a blade, a beaker type, a sclera, and a spoon knife there. These are all the surgical knives there. Coming to scissors there, we can see in the picture there. These are all the six types of the microsurgical knives used for doing perioral surgery. From the microsurgical scissors, that's called micro, they're said to be micro scissors there. And this, and they're also called extra fine micro scissors. In the waist height, it can be a curved scissor there. And the needle holder will be a miniature of the regular everything. Here we can see the microsurgical kit there, where we have a BP handle, unlike the regular one, but the miniature one. The straight scissor down there, and the curved scissor, and the needle holder there, all in the miniature size. And the microsurgical needles there. The reverse cutting needles of the significant size of 16 to 19 mm, but it's all the phage needles. This is not unsphage needle. The needle tip will be of taper point. A conventional cutting can be a reverse cutting there. A microsurgical sutures is of size of 60 or 90 sutures there. But when you ask about instruments in the exam there, you need to write up all the five types of instruments what you want to use for the microsurgery. Coming to applications of microsurgery, the using a microsurgery where they are going to do a precise surgery in the limited field of area, when you got a better healing potential, it's got various applications here. Starts from perioesthetic surgeries, that's mainly gingival incision coverage or root coverage procedures. The periodontal flap, now we are going to do a periodontal flap there. And the one main thing is we got to have better root visualization and not to remove the subgingival calculus there using the microsurgical procedures. And other one is alveolar ridge deficiencies. When you want to do alveolar ridge deficiencies and aesthetic zones there, you can go with the microsurgical procedure And the aesthetic implant reconstruction, when you want to do aesthetic implant reconstructions or any deficits in the root cover, soft tissue coverage in implant areas, a microsurgical procedure has been applied here. Even the sinus lift, minimal exposure of the area where you want to push the implant or place the implant there, the sinus lift procedure has also been applied now. And I'm going to show a case where there's a papillary reconstruction is being done with a, that's internal papillary reconstruction, how it's been done. You can see the picture number one, there is clear cut the black triangle seen between the central incisor and the lateral incisors and the first quadrant there. And the patient has usually meaning of aesthetic concern there. So when you see, when you do a microsurgery there, we can see where the internal papilla has been pushed in the coronal direction. And you can see a thin suture has been placed there. This is called microsurgical suture of 60 or 90 sutures there. And it's after 3 months, we can expect to have the internal papilla closure. A black triangle being closed in that area. It is called interdental papillary reconstruction procedures. So microsurgery is the one that's going to have various aspects in that. And second part I'm going to deal about this, say today is advances in pedology, the other one is the laser. This is a term we've been hearing for the last few decades. The lasers in periodontics there. Application of lasers got many things, but we'll be dealing about only application periodontal therapy and periodontal. As the name laser indicates that setting, but a light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation there. Different types of laser applications there. Then coming to applications of lasers in dental dentistry, the mainly that is going to have applications in cavity diagnosis called a spectroscopy. And the laser endodontics has been practiced now for root canal disinfection. We're going to disinfect the root canals there. And dental composite photopolymerization can be done. Dental holography is practiced there. The laser bleaching, that's been also practiced there. But when it comes to pedal part, we're going to use the lasers for cutting. Other one is for coagulation. That's cutting but clotting of the area, the areas of bleeding in that area. And the other one is soft tissue vaporization. That's nothing but you want to remove the tissue. That's called any growth in the tissues there. Tongue resection can be done. Removal of white lesions. Hemangiomas can be treated there, the pre-prosthetic surgery, facial nerve surgery, and on. So many procedures can be done using a laser surgery now. These are all the soft tissue lasers. I'm not going to speak about hard tissue lasers here. These are the procedures where you're going to do the only the soft tissue procedures here. It's of application of laser. Coming to the components of laser, the laser has got three components in it. It's got active medium there, an external energy source, an optical resonator. So these are the three components present in the laser. And coming to types of lasers with interaction with the matter. Matter is nothing but it can be solid, liquid, and gas. So when they interact with the matter, it's going to behave in different patterns there. So there are four interactions with the matter. The first can be a reflection of the laser beam can occur there. The laser beam can transmit to the matter there. There may be scattering of laser beam on the surface of matter. Sometimes the laser beam can get absorbed into tissues there. So this all depends upon the number of water content or hemoglobin content present in the types of the cells in the body there. Coming to the classification of lasers, according to mode of emission, the lasers have been classified into fraction laser, a continuous laser, or a pulse laser. But a fraction laser is nothing but the laser beam will be fractioned into parts there. So the beam is not a continuous procedure there. There will be fractioning of the laser beam. There will be a high energy output at a certain point and there will be break in output there. And again, there will be high energy output there and there will be break in. It's called fraction type of emission of laser. Continuous emission of laser is nothing but there will be continuous amount of power output from the laser unit at all. So there will be continuous supply of the output energy over a period of time. This could continue. Pulsed is nothing but, again, there's a difference between fraction and the pulse. The pulsing is nothing but there will be peaks increase in the energy output and there will be depletion again in the energy output there. Again, it'll go to the peak levels and there will be depletion in that. So this is three modes of emission of the. So when we see a laser equipment in there, we can see the three modes of application. It can be continuous mode or a pulsed mode there. So modes of emission, they have classified into fraction, continuous, and pulse. I go to power. power supply, they consider high power lasers, medium power lasers, low power lasers. So high power lasers is mainly thermal effective. They're mainly helping in the burning of tissues there. The medium power lasers is a photochemical effect. So that's mainly used in photodynamic therapy where they want to activate the chemical space in the pockets there. And the low power lasers, it's got photoelectric effect. The low level laser therapy, that's mainly used in the technique there. So emission, according to emitting material. So what type of material is being used in a laser? Solid laser, a gas laser, a liquid laser. So depending upon the materials, or it's a diode laser, diode is nothing but a crystal space in that, or the gas laser, what's it? It's a neon glass or anything, carbon dioxide gas laser, the liquid gas lasers. So depending upon the material that's going to emit the laser beam, they're being classified into emitting materials. Okay, we'll continue this laser topic in next class also. Thank you very much for your time in listening to the class.